I'm Bram, and here's a sobering fact. It's already too late to avoid many of the disastrous effects of climate change. Even if we collectively decide to take drastic action right now, the effects of that are going to be felt slowly, and there are several tipping points that are likely already behind us. The Arctic region may be completely ice-free during the summer in a matter of only a couple of years, which will be a devastating blow to the local biodiversity and the indigenous people who call the region their home. Natural disasters have already started to be on the rise, and that's not going to stop overnight. The amount of forest burned has doubled since 1984, and tens of millions of people already have to flee their homes yearly as a result of climate change. I wonder if Ben Shapiro would like to buy that one. Thousands of species are at the brink of extinction because of global warming, and many of them are already gone, including species that have not even been discovered yet. In the unlikely scenario that the whole world reaches the goals of the Paris Climate Accords, 1 in 6 plant and animal species is still likely to go extinct in the next 50 years, which will wreak havoc on ecosystems worldwide.
Okay, this earth is ruined!
Now, I'm not saying all this just to be depressing. I don't think we should all be doomers about this. The fact that things are inevitably gonna get bad is no excuse to not stop them from getting even worse, and a lot of bad can still be prevented. My point is that we knew this was coming, and we knew what we had to do to prevent it. And we didn't. So how much hope is there, really, that we'll do any better going forward? We know what we have to do to control the damage, and keep things from getting even worse than they need to be. But will we? When first playing Horizon Zero Dawn, many players will likely assume that the climate apocalypse actually materialized in Aloy's world. Not just because that has sort of become the default assumption for apocalyptic fiction these days, but also because the game features a lot of explicit traces of climate change. The data logs of the old world explicitly mention things like global warming, rising sea levels, and climate refugees. In a dark irony, there's a big field full of wind turbines in the game world, some of the last remains of a world they were supposed to help save. You do also find some data logs about technological attempts to save the world from its impending doom, but you'll probably dismiss them as failed attempts because, well, look around you. At some point, civilization obviously collapsed. Meanwhile, in our world, there are more than enough tech companies proposing wildly ambitious ideas on how to deal with the fallout of climate change. Sure, we could do away with most of our meat consumption to prevent it, or we could pump the air full of aerosols and literally blot out the sun, and maybe that would save some of the more vulnerable biodiversity? Sure, that would also kill a lot of plants that are reliant on sunlight, which might not be great for ecosystems itself, and it would doom us to a dystopian future in which we would never feel the sun on our faces again, but hey, just spitballing. We could put a stop to the ridiculous amount of flying we all do and heavily invest in public transport, or we could pump the oceans full of iron to stimulate the growth of plankton and just let them photosynthesize the carbon out of the air. Okay, maybe that would lead to a severe disruption of the marine ecosystem and generate massive amounts of nitrous oxide, a greenhouse gas far more damaging than carbon dioxide, but hey, this is a discussion, no wrong answers. We could demand from our governments that they mandate a complete and total transition to clean energy in the few years we still have, or we could whiten the clouds to reflect more sunlight and lower the temperature of the Earth. Sure, even proponents of that idea warn that it may have unforeseen and potentially very harmful effects on weather patterns, but hey, these are all just ideas, no reason to not at least try it. Okay, maybe an overwhelming majority of climate scientists agree that the only way to save life on the planet with any certainty is to cut carbon emissions by a dramatic amount, and maybe any form of geoengineering is an insane risk that no one should even consider when we have better options available, but think of the economic growth. We must expand further. Later on in Horizon, you learn that, against all odds, the technological approach to stopping climate change actually worked. Not only has climate change been stopped, but technological solutions, mainly from a company called the Faro Corporation, helped roll back its negative effects through geoengineering. Sure, the destructive practices of corporations pursuing infinite growth may have gotten us into this mess, but apparently they also got us out of it. So we just need to appeal to the better nature of companies and get better CEOs at the top and stakeholder capitalism and cradle to cradle and corporate responsibility and such, right? Not quite, because, you know, the world still died. All those robot dinosaurs you've been fighting throughout the game? Yeah, those were produced by the aforementioned Faro Corporation. Some of them were even part of their effort to roll back the effects of climate change. These robots, that once helped save the planet, also became its undoing. Because while the corporation stopped polluting the Earth and its atmosphere, the underlying problems that caused them to do so remained. They still operated under an economic system that demanded infinite growth, a system that granted them a disproportionate amount of power, and without any meaningful oversight of that. The Faro Corporation saw a cost-saving measure that they could implement in their machines. If these machines could process organic material for fuel and reproduce themselves, that would be a huge selling point. After all, after our engines of war have effortlessly slaughtered an entire battlefield, the corpses of the vanquished could make for a very economic power source, which they could then use to produce more war machines. Disgusting and completely emblematic of corporations' disregard for human life, but it certainly looks like a sound idea when you put it on a balance sheet. So that did not go great. At some point, control over them was lost. They started consuming living beings indiscriminately, be they plant, animal, or human. That, coupled with their capacity for reproduction and their military capabilities, meant that it was inevitable that they would eventually consume all life on Earth. Their need for infinite expansion and increasing consumption, a dark mirror to the system that almost brought Earth to ruin once before. And this time, they would not fail. This is what I think is so impressive about Horizon's exploration of climate change. It seems to posit that our problems go deeper than plane travel, meat consumption, and fossil fuels. Global warming, as much of an existential threat as it may be, is only the outcome that is to be expected of an underlying system that demands everlasting economic growth, thereby demanding ever-increasing consumption, thereby demanding an ever-growing exploitation of natural resources. I'm not sure that message was intended, but this game sure seems to suggest that capitalism is an inherently destructive system, built on the exploitation of the entire world itself and everything and everyone on it, and that it will not save us from what it itself created. Even if that's not what the devs intended to say, I think the game deserves a lot of credit for even portraying global warming and its effects. Despite the fact that climate change is literally threatening the continued existence of life on our planet, we see shockingly little representation of it in our fiction. Much less than we saw during, for example, the nuclear panic that came before. And yes, global warming is a fact. There is no meaningful scientific debate over anthropogenic climate change anymore, and if you think there is, you need to read some actual research instead of columns by scientifically illiterate reactionaries. Indian writer Amitav Ghosh has called this disconnect the Great Derangement, a title that is not so subtly alluded to in the game. The derangement seemed to only have gotten worse as the situation grew more dire, as SuperBunnyHop's video on the subject of climate change in sim games neatly demonstrates. Concerns like these are often brushed aside with the remark that games are supposed to be escapism. Setting aside for a moment the very limiting implication that that is all that games can be, escapism itself may not be such an innocent thing when the thing we're trying to escape from is an existential threat that demands action right now. So I think it could be valuable if media occasionally reminded us that yes, this is still happening, and we do still need to do something about it. Maybe guerrilla games feel the same way about that because they're Dutch. And no, I am definitely not saying that to be nationalistic. 500,000 Dutch people voted for a diet fascist who doesn't just deny climate change, but also the existence of dinosaurs, apparently. I'm saying that because Guerrilla's headquarters is in Amsterdam, which means it's between 2 and 4 meters below sea level. This shit hits close to home for us. We have defied the mighty ocean and she is coming to take her land back.
Fuck off!
The backstory of Horizon doesn't end here, by the way. While the world does indeed get destroyed, there was a successful plan to eventually reintroduce life on Earth, led by an AI who would eventually use terraforming techniques and genetic material to reform and repopulate the world. This is the Project Zero Dawn that the game is named after. Humans were meant to grow up in underground vaults where they would be educated about the world that came before. That last part didn't quite go as planned. Someone decided that the CEO of the Faro Corporation should have a seat at the table in Project Zero Dawn, instead of a seat in, say, prison, and he rightly felt so guilty about what he did that he deleted all the databanks about the old world, thinking humanity would only repeat the old world's mistakes if they were burdened by knowledge about them. And so the new world could not learn from the mistakes of the old and repeated a lot of its mistakes. It seems like race, for instance, isn't a thing people would even recognize anymore in this world, but other irrational prejudices emerge nonetheless. There's the Nora casting out those who go against their strict societal norms. There's the Carja's misogyny and only recently abolished slavery and warmongering. And there's the adversarial attitude that pretty much all of the world's different tribes have against each other, among other things. We can already see the start of history repeating itself, and it isn't much of a stretch to think that this world, too, would eventually fall for the same reasons. Humanity needs the knowledge of its mistakes to avoid repeating them. When it comes to global warming, we luckily have that knowledge. We know that it was a mistake to put greenhouse gases into the air to the degree we've been doing it. We've known about this for decades, actually. The first calculations of the greenhouse effects were done in 96. If that seems late, like it should be at least 10 or 15 years earlier, try 100 years earlier, because I was actually talking about 1896. Concern about it being an existential threat has been building since at least the 1950s, grew even more during the 60s and 70s, and overwhelming scientific consensus was reached in the 1980s. Probably would have happened earlier if Exxon hadn't kept its research on climate change secret for so long. Top Exxon executives were briefed about the disastrous effects of man-made climate change as early as 1981, and then they spent the following decades blocking solutions to it and funding climate change denial.
A meteor, three times the size of Earth, is heading towards us in a collision course that will result in the extinction of all life on this planet. This just in? No, it's not.
Ah, good.
When it comes to policy, scientific knowledge is only as powerful as people's belief in it. And decades of corporate-funded news media and snowball-throwing politicians in the pocket of energy companies didn't help in that respect. The Bush administration actually pressured scientists to eliminate words like global warming and climate change from their findings. That's how deeply he was in the pocket of people like the Koch brothers. Oh, I'm sorry, Koch brother! My point is, we know many of the architects of the oncoming apocalypse, and we know many of their addresses. I think Horizon is right if it does indeed try to suggest that we can only save life on this planet if we take scientific knowledge seriously. But I also feel I should be clear that swaying the public opinion will not be enough. The US is probably the country most poisoned with anti-climate change propaganda. Even there, 57% of the people know that global warming is happening, and that it's happening because of us. As with many things, though, in the US and elsewhere, corporate money infects political decision-making to such an extent that policies do not match this public belief at all. Voting for the relatively climate-conscious party or candidate every 4 years isn't gonna cut it, especially not in pseudo-democracies, flawed democracies like the United States, where powerful lobbying groups for the rich influence policy more than the public at large ever could. Quote-unquote consumer activism isn't gonna help much either, because there are pretty much no products that don't contribute to global warming in some way. Like, buy as local and cyclical as you can, but individuals are powerless when giant corporations collectively seem determined to squeeze every last drop of fossil fuel out of the earth. Consequences be damned. I'm not saying this to absolve individuals of any and all responsibility for their actions, but I do want to make clear that the impact of individual consumer choices is far too limited to save us at this point. You may have heard of ecological footprints, a number designed to represent an individual's environmental impact. Yeah, that was created by BP, in a very successful attempt to shift the blame for global warming from corporations to individuals. We are not going to offset the environmental impact of Exxon by cycling to work and getting energy-saving lamps. Fossil fuel companies pull shit like this all the time.
Greenzo is America's first non-judgmental, business-friendly environmental advocate.
The free market will solve global warming, if that even exists.
My point.
Shell did a miniseries called The Great Travel Hack, in which two teams had to get from point A to point B using newly developed quote-unquote low-carbon technologies like hydrogen cars, competing to emit the lowest amount of CO2 on their journey. Shit like this allows Shell to put on an environmentally friendly face while changing very little about how they actually operate. Oh, and both teams would have emitted less CO2 if they had taken the train, because, again, the solutions are already available and we do not need to wait for huge leaps in technology to seriously get started on this. We need to demand that companies are forced to make the transition before it's definitively too late, because they will not do it out of the goodness of their hearts. Their shareholders tend to be old enough that they'll never see the worst consequences of global warming, and often rich enough to weather its early effects. In the slightly longer, but not that much longer run, we need to transition to a different economic system. One that doesn't give huge amounts of power to ever-hungry, ever-expanding entities with no regard for their impact on people and the planet, and no accountability to anyone but their shareholders. The reality, the inconvenient truth, if you will, is that things are not just going to get worse, they're going to get worse than they need to get. They're going to get worse in preventable ways. But we can't give up. We can't just give in to climate grief, because when we collectively decide to snap out of our derangement, there needs to be something left to salvage. Again, we know what's coming. So let's make that count for something. That is a bummer. Speaking of bummers, this is the part of the video where I have to ask you to like, subscribe, or maybe watch one of my other videos to feed the hungry algorithm. Or maybe just because you liked it. I don't know. Anyways, thanks for watching.